to Mr. Webster's dictionary to find what exactly that term means and where it came from. Originally, it would seem that the word came from the mid-1800s in reference to a circus parade. Anyone here ever been to a circus parade? You're old enough, huh? Evidently, in decades past, when a circus would come to town, there would be a parade through the streets with the various animals and acts in the circus. And among the parade lineup would be a high and ornate wagon carrying a band of musicians who would play lively music for the purpose of stirring up people's interest and passion for attending the circus. Today, the term has come to primarily follow Mr. Webster's second or third definitions, any cause or group that has attracted followers by its timeliness, its showmanship or momentum, or the definition, a current or fashionable trend. What bandwagons are people getting on today? Well, it depends upon what circle of folks you find yourself in. What are the most current fashions or trends? Well, if you're under 40, or maybe 50, it seems body piercing and tattoos are a fashion, right? From ears to eyebrows to noses to tongues, people, male and female alike, are poking holes in themselves and putting rings through them. And I'll be the first to admit, I don't understand it, but I don't judge, okay? I've been sort of old since I was young. But you know, lest we who are in that over 50 generation become too self-righteous and judgmental, we too have jumped on our own bandwagons, haven't we, at times? From politics to sports to entertainment to religion, we all at times have followed the trend. We all like to be on the side of the winner. It's far more comfortable to go along with the crowd or take a stand that's already popular than to go against the tide or to stay the course. The church even gets on bandwagons, doesn't it? Back in the 30s and 40s, it was big time multi-week tent revival. Anyone ever been to one of those? In the 50s, it was Sunday school. That's why every traditional church around here has these huge educational wings. We built Sunday school rooms, right? In the 60s and the 70s, it was youth coffee houses and folk music. In the 80s, a return to traditional family values. The 90s, 2000s, and on, it's been the mega church, right? It's the trend. It's the fashion. Now, some of these bandwagons have brought some good things, some positive things. But if the bandwagon is all that we have, if it's all that we believe in, if our faith is riding only on the bandwagon, well, what can happen? Scripture from this morning that Sheila just read tells us. Jesus prepares to enter the city of Jerusalem. What does it mean that he's come to Jerusalem? We get the idea that this was no spur-of-the-moment decision. Rather, Jesus had been planning for some time that just at the right time, in the right way, he would come to Jerusalem. And he would carry a powerful message. In the fashion of the prophets, Jesus used his actions to convey God's word. So he came into the city riding on what? On a donkey. Now, had Jesus had an agent, which he didn't, or any other of our modern-day image makers, they would have advised Jesus against coming to the city on a donkey. After all, if Jesus was to take Jerusalem by storm, he needed a more dramatic and regal means for making his grand entrance. There's very little grand about a donkey, right? But Jesus was not concerned about him. Jesus was concerned about mission. He rode a donkey because it fulfilled the prophecy that God's Messiah would come in gentleness and humbleness and in peace. You see, gentleness and humbleness and peace do not a good bandwagon make. Bold and big, bright and flashy are what a set a bandwagon rolling. But despite his meager means of arrival, the crowds, who no doubt were much aware of the previous his previous ministry in Galilee, welcomed Jesus as the king they longed for him to be. They waved their palms and they shouted their hosannas, not fully aware of the truth of their praise. As the small entourage made its way toward Jerusalem, the crowds along the way picked up, and the bandwagon was rolling along pretty good. And the children who seemed to always see Jesus for who he really is, in their honest innocence, led the chorus of hosannas, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord."
Amen.
It was an exuberant, joyous parade. Many that day jumped on the bandwagon. Because you see, they thought Jesus was coming to bring immediate deliverance of the Jewish people from the tyranny of the Romans. They thought that Jesus was here to set into motion a political revolution that would restore Israel to its greatness during the time of King David. Many who shouted and waved palms that day placed their faith in a bandwagon that Jesus was not riding. They thought they knew what Jesus was all about. But it would seem that in reality they had no clue as to what Jesus was about. For the bandwagon which rolled full steam ahead this day of triumphal entry would soon come to a screeching halt. Waving palms would give way to raised fists. Shouts of Hosanna would soon turn into cries of crucify him. Many who rode the bandwagon of Jesus' praise on this day would in a matter of hours jump to the bandwagon of his condemnation. You see, that's the trouble with bandwagons. They can quickly run out of gas, or worse yet, change direction. Too often, they're fueled on momentary passions instead of deep-seated sense of mission or purpose. Those who join bandwagons are often shallow in their commitment and short-sighted and narrow-minded in their viewpoints. Bandwagons often carry the worst of our prejudice instead of calling forth the best in our character. The movement Jesus came to initiate was not a bandwagon. Jesus never commissioned a public opinion poll before he took a stand. He never worried about his image or how what he said would be received by those in the seats of influence. He never let the threat of criticism or ridicule keep him from doing what he saw as his Father's will or work. And he wasn't afraid of being labeled a liberal or a conservative, a fundamentalist or a radical. Jesus was fully aware that day that the crowds waved their palm branches and proclaimed their praises. He was fully aware it would not last. He knew that the mission to which he was called would not always win him the world's adulation. He knew that in only a matter of hours he would be at the temple, his Father's house, clearing the money changers, challenging those who would put greed or selfishness above his Father's business. He knew that his message of unconditional love and acceptance for all people, irregardless of who your daddy was, would threaten those who claimed exclusive rights to the title God's people. He knew that the Roman politicians would cave in to the pressures of the religious establishment, and he knew that even some of his closest disciples in the coming days would betray and deny him to save their own skin. He knew all of this, and yet he remained steady on his course. He knew all of this and remained courageous and firm in his convictions. Jesus modeled for us in his final days what it truly means to live a life of faith. For you see, when the winds of popular opinion, or the winds of life problems, or the storms of chaos blow violently around us, we can frantically jump from bandwagon to bandwagon, hoping that one of them will carry us to safety, or we can cling to our anchor, who hung on that old rugged cross, Jesus the Christ, and move steadily forward on our course. As I reflected upon history for examples of those who modeled this kind of faith, I thought of the early Christians who did not have the security of being the majority, and they practiced their faith in secret code. I thought of the great reformers of the church who, in the face of burning at the stake, stood tall for what they knew the gospel to be all about. And I thought about in more recent times, those who fought for civil rights in our own land, those who quietly sat at the lunch counter labeled whites only while being taunted and threatened, knowing they were doing God's will and work. As I thought about my own personal experience in ministry, many models of faith came to my mind. Some of you came to my mind. As I watch you weather the storms of life, illness, physical and mental, addictions, money problems, weather those storms, disappointments life can bring, and still keep coming back. Steady and strong in faith. Bandwagons. I'm not sure how useful they are, and I pray to God we're not one. A colleague of mine in ministry who carries out a ministry much similar to what we're doing said to me when I had lunch with her a few weeks ago, you know, sometimes I worry that folks come just because it's the popular thing to do. Don't come because it's the popular. Come because it's what God wants you to do. And keep coming for that reason. In fact, I think we ought to be careful about joining causes or movements that try to place us on bandwagons. Perhaps we should have what the Apostle Paul says, as for me, this sort of faith, as for me, I choose to know nothing but Christ and Him crucified. From the old hymn, this morning, as we enter the most sacred time for any of us as a follower of Christ when we get to come to His table, from the old hymn, these words come to mind. Beneath the cross of Jesus, I'll take my stand. In the shadow of a mighty rock, within a weary man. I ask no other sunshine than what? The sunshine of His face. Content to let the world go by in all its bandwagons. To know no gain nor loss. My sinful self, my only shame. What's my glory? My glory. As we journey with you, Lord, one more time to the holy city and to the events that carried you all the way to Golgotha's hill, keep us steady on our course. Even when we encounter challenges along the way, even when things we do may not be received with adulation or popularity, keep us steady on the course. The course is your unconditional love and forgiveness shown to us and modeled for us.